This is the, thank you. It's a new experience for me. I've never worked this way before, knowingly. I think in a subtle sense, we're often in each other's spaces and we exchange thoughts and we're working together in many different ways. So this is, this just brings us a little bit more from the virtual into the real, even if the real and the virtual are absolutely working together. And I wanted to really say we're having a dialogue within the workshop of the soul. Each one of us is directly connected to our own inner school, our own inner team, and each of us is very much working to be responsible, a shared responsibility, really, but responsible for the way in which the ideals and ideas that we share can enter into the world without becoming dogmatic and without entering into some sort of fixed, repetitional structure. The concept of the workshop of the soul is always originality and individuality within a collective relationship. So the value of each and every one of us and the ideas, the uniqueness of what each of us may bring through or bring forth becomes more important than listening to somebody else and then repeating what we have heard. It's always fresh vegetables grown in our own garden, even if we're all growing potatoes, carrots, and tomatoes. They're from our own garden and they're fresh. And this is very much what we encourage. So the workshop of the soul, we like to say, is in the fifth dimension, which means it's connected to the causal body, which really in another way says it is the point where the incarnation in the earth is connected to the higher or cosmic purpose and relationships of the soul. So that we have many levels simultaneously, and we are active on all of them, and we are linked to many points in time and in space, and yet we are here now. So that is the significance of here and now that becomes the reality, at least the reality. Now, the fifth dimension is also bringing us into the linear line of time and the collective sense of the continuum. And this means that we are within the relationship of all things to all things. And this is a general sense, of course, but it is very specific to each individual. Nothing is left to chance. There is no casual collision, as it were. Everything is working within the sense of divine right order. And while this sounds fine, in practice, it's quite not always so clear, at least quite difficult, I would say, to appreciate what that really, really means. Now, it's from the workshop of the soul that we have the resource that flows in, and it flows into the collective, and then it flows into the individual. It flows in usually through the crown chakra, and then it enters into the pathways through which light, like water, will flow without being bothered by any obstacles. It will flow either through them or around them or over them or under them. But the light itself is never diminished, and it is always reaching as far and in every possible way without creating unnecessary confrontation or conflict. So it is within the workshop of the soul that is the unending resource and the continuous sense of relationship into wherever there is a question that is seeking an answer, and there is never a limit, and there is never in any way a sense of somehow not being pure and private within our own specific spiritual connections. Now, we're interested then in the interdimensional or higher dimensional influences that are working in these times. And it is important at least to begin to tell us our own story, as it were, not so much to wait for somebody else to interpret it all, but that we have our own impressions, we have our own images and feelings, and these have a significance, they're important, and the relationship of our ideas as we share them, either directly or within the same atmosphere and the same sense of feeling, is very important, very significant. The teaching that comes through is not through one individual. The value of the interdimensional work in these times comes out of a collective within which the individual is supremely respected in one way. But in fact, it comes out of the originality of the collective. And so it's a time that takes us beyond the need for a single ashram or a single overriding guru or teacher. And we are all part of the same sunlight, the same soul light, the same cosmic relationship light. And this is where the significance, I think, of meeting even in this way comes in. We're all in the same space within ourselves. We're in the same time, but we're all in different time zones and we're all in different spaces. And it is this beautiful, I could say, contrast, really, that makes the value of the living moment. We're all listening together, and yet we're all in different places. We're all sharing these ideas, and yet we're not sharing them by being in some way in one room. And in fact, the inner school, or the higher centers of schooling, work with us in this way. They link with us in whatever our time zone, and they will link with us in whatever the circumstances. And we're not stuck to rules and regulations. There is a sense of safety or security, or we could call it environmental protection. But there is enormous freedom. And then all of us, in listening to this or in sharing in this and contributing into this in this way, belong to the overall value and principles of our inner team and our many life structure. So the influences that are coming in, shows itself, at least from my perspective, is it's entering into the chakra system, and there's an updating of the chakra system. Now, these are purely observations, feelings, and impressions. They're not said with any sense of authority. We're all like journalists traveling through this virtual relationship. And we've each got the importance of each of us is from where we stand and how we see it. And this is where I am and how it shows itself from my perspective. Now, there is an influx of starlight, we say. There are new frequencies of light entering in from, well, they've always been there, but we are becoming more receptive to them in one way, but also they're entering in because we are in a different part of space that is new to the solar system and then new to the Earth in its own specific way. In this sense, there is a shift within the chakra system, which opens up the appreciation of new frequencies of light, of new pathways of light, of new relationships through starlight into the cosmic information, cosmic purpose, into the light beings that manage it all, and into the sense of belonging. That as the chakra system is switched on a little bit more, then it works more and more in the collective sense. It's so interesting that we think of the chakras individually, but with this relationship more to the cosmic frequencies through the, what we then call the causal body, or the workshop of the soul, the chakra centers tend to work more collectively, they're not so much separate, but more, for example, the first and second chakras work very much as one chakra. Excuse me. And then the first three chakras work as one chakra. The solar plexus as the heart work as one chakra. The heart and the throat work as one chakra. The head centers together all work as one chakra. And then according to the different types of, what could we say, the type of invitation of the circumstances. So we literally combine in whatever aspect awakens the level of consciousness, which actually it programs, it awakens, it works through mostly not so much for what we see and hear in a rational way or an obvious way, but places us within a sense of being present, being more whole, feeling much more aware without having to think about what it is that we are aware of. It's just a sense of being conscious and awake. There's a raising of the level of just, we're a bit more together. We can think more clearly. And while this this comes because we are linked together here and now to some degree, it becomes the general way. It becomes, if you could call it, the new normal that's coming in more and more. Now, these higher frequencies coming into the base chakra, for example, have got so much to do with resources. And it's not so much our own resources in terms of the Kundalini energy. Definitely, of course, it tunes it, if you like. It doesn't need to be awakened, but it does need to be tuned like even a radio receiver or even a telephone. It needs to be able to connect. And the working of the higher frequencies into the base chakra makes us far more conscious of our relationship to nature and the earth. The actual sense of, you know, we call it instinctive intelligence, but the instincts are often thought of in a more animal level in a way. And this is much more a sense of valuing the resources of the earth. It's to do with the energies and the sources of energy. And the instinctive side is also very much linked to the relationship between ourselves and the elements. And so immediately in the world, we're looking at climate and climate change. We're looking at the purity of the water and the air and the pollution of the seas and what is our source of energy and our sources of light. So the whole world is very conscious of this. It's going to take a few years. It doesn't matter. But the awareness is to do with the relationship in this way of looking through the base chakra, that is through the higher centers or the higher senses being switched on a little bit more. Now through the second chakra, it's very much to do with the communities and it's also to do with belief systems and the relationships of people of different faiths and colors jobs and personality differences and everything. And of course, this is a very special time now. The whole world is coming into the respect for each other, a balance between men and women, and an appreciation and giving space for people with all sorts of different normals that are normal to them, even if they do not always agree with dogma and history. The normal is the basis of the normal is for the love and acceptance of each other and the awareness of being able to see through the eyes of others and to be able to appreciate through the hearts and minds of others. So the second chakra very much is active in its being stimulated or actually awakened more into the very world situation of ecology, but also the respect for people of different genders, equality of pay, and equality of opportunity, and then to all colors, shapes, and sizes. We get a surfacing of history, of all the abuse and the exploitation and the man's inhumanity, but it's brought into the light, not into the shadow of repetition, but into the light of resolution. Because the generation that remembers it today will not repeat it. And the children of this generation will come from a different level of consciousness. But the children that will be born from today's generations, or perhaps many children already who have been born, but they are still quite young. They do not belong to the history that is, if you like, the history of my generation. They belong to a history which is waiting to be written, in a world that is, in principle, still awaiting to be discovered and formed. Now, coming to the third chakra is really interesting, because most of our belief systems have a foundation which is extraordinary and beautiful and noble and uplifting. It's inspired. It has a cosmic connection. It has a way of triggering the highest ideals in everyone. And at the same time, the solar plexus level is so much linked to superstition, dogma, repetition, and the use of and the abuse of authority to have power over and to control, and also the interpretation of wisdom, of gospel, of scripture, but to interpret it in a way that favors those who control it, and those that do not agree become somehow disciplined, or they certainly become negatively involved. The very teachings which should emancipate and release from the old solar plexus, we could say, become imprisonment and dogmatic. And there is a lot of evidence of that. But now we see the evidence, if you like, of a different relationship. Because when we come from the solar plexus, which we can also call the old heart, to the new heart, and the awakening of this heart chakra is really interesting, because it is the light of the soul where the questions that we want to ask do not have an intellectual construct, and they don't come from our ordinary rational foundations. The questions that we ask through the heart are always related to contribution, the path of, we call it the path of service, but the path of service is not subjection into doing some repetitional road building or slavery. It's exactly the opposite. The heart is the heart of freedom, but it's the heart of freedom that manages, that contains man's inhumanity. It is the heart that also works with what in the solar plexus becomes a sense of addiction, compulsion, and obsession. It becomes through the heart into a sense more of emancipation, and also of being able to live within the midst of temptation, in the midst of various all kinds of you could say enslaving forces, to literally being able to take just a taste of it and to know how much is enough. It's to be able to be in the midst of temptation in a certain way, but actually not need to compensate or not need to become addicted. And so then we come to the throat center with this what we call the almost like the updating of it all, the interdimensional influences in the throat center. It's very much the higher frequency of the second chakra. It's very much linked to the wisdom that will come through each individual and the originality that if we are able to express it, it is also because we regard it and we observe it and we acknowledge it in everyone else. So that's it's so interesting to see the ancient wisdom as it comes through the throat center, and through the throat center as it is awakened begins to resolve so many of the relationships in families and relationships in all the different ways in which we are fragmented into caste systems and hierarchies and so on. It's really interesting to appreciate as the throat center is interdimensionally awakened, and as the workshop of the soul begins to find its expression as the light of the soul through the heart and through the throat, it becomes a world which will not poison itself, but will actually begin to transform you could say, like in a homeopathic way, the poisons into medicines. Now, ancient evil man's inhumanity are very similar, but in a slightly different way. The history of darkness can literally be potentized, if you like. There is a beautiful and divine principle which can be released when it is approached, contemplated, embraced, meditated, included, and through the throat center, it begins to become more significant or more obvious or more just a fact within our own lives. Now, when the higher frequencies coming into the brow chakra, we're really working with the rebuilding or the regaining of the child when in its early years, so that there is no interruption of the light of the soul within the child as the brain continues to form, especially within the first 9 months after birth, and then within the first 7 years of our life. We are still very vulnerable through our, you could say, through our karmic, what we call them, significant points of significance. Then we are still very vulnerable, easily working in a sense of compensation or defense or reactive projection. And very often the light of the pure light of the divine principle of the incarnation is diminished under many forms of just survival. And we find when the brow chakra, when the light comes into the brow chakra from the workshop of the soul and the higher levels, then from the causal levels, as we say, or the cosmic relationship levels, then we find the purity of the purpose of incarnation is maintained within the developmental processes of the child in the first 9 months after being born, and then within the first 7 years. And there is a sense in the area, for example, of the fontanelle area, that this is gently contained, but it is never diminished and it is never closed down. And this allows, and this is the key, as we come into fourth dimensional living, which is where mankind is entering at this time, that we are able to manage the reality of awakening to many other beings that are invisible to us, but who share the same space and the same everything that we do, but we either believe or we don't believe in them, or they're just superstitious nonsense, or we're full of the fear of all these forces. Now, with the light coming into the brow chakra and then coming more into the crown itself, we find that we're able to enter into a different spectrum of light, actually, a different horizon of perception. And then our own containment of the anchor points of our own sanity and reality can gradually be safely opened, safely awakened, and we can be in the midst of an invisible world, which we could probably look at under a microscope or under some quantum type of telescope. And so then we don't need to theorize about the history of the universe. We can open more consciously and awarely into it all. It's really very interesting. The light coming into the crown chakra brings us into a different relationship to the many life structure, and also to the nature of the continuous updating of the information of why we are here and what we have come to do, virtually moment by moment. Life is a continuous flow of information into events as they unfold, opens up. Now, all of this works progressively and retrospectively, actually. There are so many points where we are in some way interrupted or hung up. There is a point of fixation, and there are areas which we say are in a state of stasis or inertia. And in these states and stages, we share this collectively, and we are involved with them that are fixed into spaces and places and buildings. They are fixed into repetitional states politically, economically, ideologically, And through the crown chakra and the continuous flow of updating, as it comes in more and more, we could say, gently, spontaneously, so that the awakening does not become dangerous in the sense of overloading, and it does not become open in an obsessional way, where we're off in some strange direction, but much more the sense of the expansion of what we then call the expanding reality of what is normal. Now, we've got to give ourselves 200 or 300 or 400 years, but not for it to happen overnight in 400 years' time, but to appreciate the gradual emergence through our own incarnation now, and then with the new children that are coming in, with the new souls that are incarnating. It's not so much that we're looking for great individuals, but we look for the collective relationship between souls that have already almost a telepathic relationship, but it's not to read each other's thoughts, but it's just to share in a way where what we can call false news it cannot have any domination. And the way in which so much reportage is a manipulation of what certain people in authority would perhaps like us to believe, and in the way in which we live in a world which is dominated by the advertisement conditioning, that with these higher centers all being a little bit more awakened and open, they're still there. They all do their best or their worst. And at the same time, we are able to discriminate. We know where is the good and where is the not good. And we don't end up by having to polarize. We're not fighting against. We are always in coordination and cooperation with. And then we can choose when to say no. We can also work with what is called spiritual economy of how much is enough and so on. Now this is the updating of the chakra system, and it's really, really interesting, at least from this way of interpreting it, to then look into the world, and we look then for the indicators that give us a sense of confirmation, or we're all going crazy together. And if we look at the world today, there is a sense of confirmation. There's an encouragement. And there is also the sense of the dissemination of ideas rather than the centralization of ideas through one person or one group. The dissemination means that the world is full of many, many messiahs, many Buddhists, you know, many, many Muhammads, many great and beautiful illumined souls, and not enough to overwhelm too many in a way which separates, but always just enough that opens up the relationship of, we call it sympathy and harmonic resonance. Now, this is interesting because the way in which the higher worlds are working with incarnation is very much through the forces of light, which in these times is linked to the Michael and Gabriel forces, as they are called. The whole principle of light and color into incarnation is entering into a completely new phase. Ronald Beasley originated and developed the color treatment at a distance, and in coordination with the light scientists in the higher dimensions. So there is the way is developed of being able to work through light and color to reach the individual wherever they are and at whatever level they are receptive into supporting them. And this is evolving more and more now into the direct support of the whole of mankind, not waiting for people to ask for help, but for the process having reached a point of significance, we could say where the will to good collectively is sufficient, that they can begin to work into the whole of mankind. It's really interesting. So that now the points of significance becomes, you know, where has been the point of conception? Where is the place of birth, the time, the country? Who are the family of origin? What is their race, their belief system? What is your gender? What is the history of the country and the people with whom you have incarnated? And then also we look to see when is the previous death? Because death this is very significant. What is interesting is each birth helps to clear the shadows of previous deaths until there is no shadow of any death at all, until there is no death, really. But the points of significance, as they are anchored through the through the color and light scientists, more and more individually, but they're individually into the collective of that individual and then into the group, more and more of the different networks of belonging. So there is the sense of freeing the incarnation into the flow, the fullest flow of its significance. And when we observe the work that is going on, initially it was just helping people in the everyday, wherever we are in our lives right now. And we all need quite a lot of help day by day. But we see it entering more and more from the physical body into the etheric, which is the general health aura. And so we will gradually be seeing the diminishing of many forms of disease and the raising of the general level. It's not so much of immunity. It's more the nature of being able to work with all the forces of nature intelligently, the intelligence within the body's biochemistry and its relationship emotionally, intellectually, psychically, and spiritually. And so we see the work, the light entering more and more now. It was in the physical body and the ordinary psychological structure, then into the etheric body, which is the general health structure. And each of these goes more and more from the individual into the group and the group into the larger and larger collective. And then when we go further into the astral body, where it is entering now more and more significantly, it enters also into the historical processes. And this is really interesting, because here we find that many of our faults and shortcomings, many of our fears and phobias, many of the vulnerability to areas of addiction and compulsion and obsession, these go back in history of time, but time is timeless because they are with us here and now in a certain very real sense. And it enters into the dissolving of historical collective static patterns, repetitional patterns. Now, to see this being dissolved and released is where we find that, if you like, the United States of America can become the United States of North and South America. The different countries of Europe, creating a sort of common market, become the United States of Europe, as it were. And we gradually are enlarging the horizons of the nature of what is becoming one humanity, one family of man. Now, also, when we see the dissolving of these historical shadows, we're opening up the direct connection into what is called the Akashic Records. We're so interested in history, and we're looking at buildings like the pyramids and all the ruins of many places. We dig up old bones and we try to read all the ancient books that are still available somehow. But there is, of course, the records of everything. Nothing is ever forgotten. It all remains. And it is not just remembered. It's a living state. Memory is a state that continues to be present and active. And it continues to be alive, really, within what we call the reality of the nature of the investment of the soul into the history of its own consequences. Now, what is so fascinating is, as the Akashic Records become more available, the sense of the continuity of life, that there is no death, that we live in a physical body, but actually we have an astral body. At least we have an astral body, and we're off every night into the spheres and we return. But that when physical life is completed, we continue to, if not exist, we continue to live vitally, more and more vitally and more intelligently or more consciously, with the entering into the, of the light and the light workers, the light scientists, therapists, physicians, teachers, as this enters into the astral body level and the deeper subconscious and collective memories, we begin to see the history of mankind, and we will see the life of the Buddha and the Christ, of Muhammad, of Krishna, of Moses, of all the, of Zoroaster, of all the great teachers. And we will be able to appreciate not only their individual life, but the great hierarchy of souls that incarnate through them and with them, and they incarnate under the umbrella, if you like, of these extraordinary higher beings. Now, all of this is in the process of opening and awakening. And we think of it in terms of our own lifetime, and here we are. And yet, the feeling of it having already been happening for a while, and that we belong to the continuity of it, and it will go on for the next millennium, at least quite some time, when we can be in touch from this level, from other levels, and we'll be coming and going a few times in the process. All of this becomes part of the continuity of remembering, and this is what is very exciting. And excuse me, it is this continuity of remembering that then is the, we say, the awakening of the more complete and more whole person. Every chakra center is being updated, we say. It's being wakened up in its frequency. All of this works into all the areas of the body to which they are related and which depend on them. All of this connects directly into the frequencies of light that are coming from the sun and the reflected light of the moon. But now it becomes also more and more directly corresponding to starlight that is coming in. And it is the starlight frequencies that become involved in our interdimensional medicine and in it into our interdimensional light therapy. It's really, really interesting. So the bottom line within it all is the awakening of what we call the originality and the creativity. This the sense of the world being filled with people who don't have to follow anybody, but who follow together the theme and the dream to which they are harmonically resonant. And when this happens, we begin to see the flow through history of our belonging and the flow through the different dimensions of our simultaneous presence here and now. And then, if you like, we go to sleep in our bodies, but we wake up upstairs, and we have to let go upstairs for a while, and we wake up in our physical bodies. And the flow between waking and sleeping is diminished, and we remain continuously conscious. And our life, which which may last as long as it needs to last, becomes a state of continuity, so that by the time that we are ready to depart from this level, the translation is almost unnoticed. It's a sense of continuity. There's no post-mortem. There's the continuous life. And there is the sense also of no longer being drawn into the fear and superstition of judgment and heaven and hell. Now, these ideas are there just to share for a moment as we link for the first time in this way. It's very much to acknowledge who you are, what you are doing, what you are feeling drawn to, the ideas that inspire you, and the way in which you're growing all the same vegetables, but you're growing them fresh in your own garden. And we are sharing those amongst those whom we meet and who are drawn to us. And in one way or another, we are each an entry point into the very translation of mankind in its fragmented sense into a beautiful, living, and whole humanity. Okay, thank you very much.